Hari Om. We'll chant from verse number 12. Moghasha mogha karmanah. Mogha jnana vichetasah. Rakshasi masurin chaiva. Prakritim mohinim shritaha mahatmanastumam partha daivim prakritim ashritaha bhajantyananyamanasaha jnatva bhutadim avyayam Satatam kirtayanto maam Yatantascha dhridavrataha Namasyantascha maam bhaktya Nityayukta upasate Jnana yadnena chapyanye Yajanto maam upasate Ekatvena prithaktvena Bahudha vishvato mukham Aham kraturaham yajnaha Swadhahamaham aushadham Mantro hamahame vajjam Aham agniraham hutam So Bhagavan He says that there are some foolish people who don't recognize me when I take avatar, when I appear in a particular form. So when we don't recognize Ishvara, who is also residing in our heart, who is present in front of us as this wide world, we develop a lot of desires and perform various types of karma, but all goes in vain. We don't achieve the lasting happiness, lasting peace. So people who do this, they are as though taking refuge in Rakshasi and Asuri Sampatti, Prakriti. But Mahatmas, good people, they take support of Bhagavan's Daivi Prakriti and worship Him constantly. Satatam kirtayanto maam yatantascha dhridavrataha. With a firm resolve, these Mahatmas, they worship Bhagavan, do namaskar to Him, see His presence everywhere. Ekatvena prataktvena vishvato mukham. In various ways, one worships Bhagavan through jnana yajna also. Whatever way one worship, it reaches that Ishvara. Whatever way means as guided by the scriptures, because He is present in everything. He is present in Kratu, He is present in Yajna, in Swadha, in Aushadha, in Mantra, in Ajya, in Agni, in the entire Hutam. Bhagavan alone is present. So one has to worship Him with full devotion. So, in order to recognize my own presence, my own self, the innermost self, we have to purify our mind and meditate. And in order to recognize the presence of Ishvara in this whole world, we have to worship Him constantly in various ways. So upasana. So through this upasana, we will be able to recognize our identity with Ishvara. So who is Ishvara? What is His nature? That is being presented now in the following verses. So verse number 17. Pitahamasya jagatah Mata dhata pitamahah Vedyam pavitram omkarah Riksamaya jurevacha Pitahamasya jagatah Mata dhata pitamahah Bhagavan says, Pita aham asya jagatah. I am the father of this world. I am the father of this entire creation. This vast creation is there. Infinite, the space itself is infinite, with so many different worlds and different types of beings. The gross world, the subtle world, the causal world, it's very vast. Bhagavan says, I am the father of this world. I have given birth to this world. So father, but who is the mother? Many times we might say Bhagavan is our father, but we should also know who is the mother. So he says, I am the mother also. Pita aham asya jagatah mata. Mata aham. Mata also myself. I am the mother and I am the father of this world. So Ishvara is the parent of this world. And this whole world is the child of Ishvara. Bhagavan ka hi mano beta hai. Bhagavan hi us roop mein hai. Ishvara alone is present in the form of this world. So pita and mata aham means I am the nimitta as well as upadan karan of this world. Upadan karan means the material which goes to make this world is also Ishvara. And the one who converted this material into this world is also Ishvara. Just like we have a pot and the pot maker and clay. So clay is the material cause, upadan, and the pot maker is the one who converts this clay into a pot. So similarly, what is the clay of this world? Ishvara or Brahma. And who is the pot maker? Ishvara alone. He is both the pot maker as well as the clay, and this world is like a pot. So pita aham asya jagatah mata, I am the mother of this world also. Therefore Bhagavan's presence is there in everything. He himself is the material cause. So material cause is present in the effect. The entire effect is pervaded by the cause. Just like the pot is pervaded by clay. What is present in front of us as a pot is nothing but clay only, in a particular shape. But that shape can change, but clay remains as it is. As the pot maker, you must have seen the pot maker making the pot, it puts the clay and then turns the wheel and gives it a shape. And as it gives it, it keeps on changing also. Sometimes puts it hands inside and use some type of shape. So the shape keeps on changing as it is being made, but still the clay remains same. Clay doesn't change. Clay was clay before the pot was made. Clay is clay when the pot is being seen. And clay remains clay when the pot gets again dissolved into the clay. So Bhagavan, Ishvara, Brahma is the clay and Brahma is the pot maker and this world is the pot. So Pitahamasya Jagataha. Also, when we pray to Ishvara, we can pray to him as our own father and mother. See, from our parents only we get all samskar. Good, bad, not good, bad, bad, but good. Samskars, good. So we get all samskar from our parents. We get all support from our parents, right type of education, etc. We get from our parents. But our worldly parent, they are there giving birth to this particular body. And once I die, I am born again, I get some other parents. So my parents keep on, worldly parents keep on changing. Because I have taken so many births, I might not remember, but so many births and different births, different parents. But the ultimate parent is Father, I mean the Ishvara alone, who remains same. He remains all the time with us. So he is our father and mother. Pita hamasya jagataha mata. But this whole world with so many different beings, who supports this world? Who is the protector of this world? Who nourishes all the beings in this world? Bhagavan says, I nourish the world. Dhata. I am the one who nourishes this world by giving the result of the karmas which are performed by all these jivas. So karma phalasya pranibhyah vidhata, by giving them the respective results of their karma. So it's so complex, the whole world is so very complex. We perform action, we get the result. The result is not created by us. We have the ability to perform action, but the result is not in our hand. That's what we saw in the second chapter also. Ki karmanneva adhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana. We can perform action, but what type of result will come, we don't know. Because result depends not only on our karma, but so many other factors. So then the result comes, but who keeps in mind all these factors and who gives us the result? Ishvara. We get result not only in this life, but in future also. So who keeps all this in mind? Ishvara. Ishvara gives us the result. So he is the dhata. So he is the father, mother and the dhata of this world. As when we talk about the world, we talk about that supreme reality as the father and mother, as Ishvara. But otherwise, it is pure that Brahma. And in that Brahma, there is neither the world, there is nor any jivas, nothing. From the standpoint of Brahma, there is nothing. Just like if you look at the pot, from the standpoint of shape and all, we call it a pot. But if you just look from the standpoint of clay, there is nothing but clay only there. Other than clay, nothing is there. Just like these letters on this book, if you look from the point of the shape and all, then different letters are there, different words are there. It creates a beautiful story, beautiful image. But if you look at it just as color, then it is just color only. Kala akshar. Nothing is there. It's only color. Similarly, from the standpoint of that supreme reality, it's everything is Brahma alone. So he is the Pitamaha of this world also. So Mata, Dhata, Pitamaha. Pitamaham is father of the father also. So Bhagavan is the father, but he himself is the grandfather also. And himself is the mother. He himself is the protector and nourisher of this world. See, all this we should remember. When we say we worship Ishvara, we should remember his nature and worship. And so many verses, so many pointers are there pointing the glories of Ishvara. So, Pitahamasya Jagataha Mata Dhata Pitamaha. I am the grandfather. Vedyam. I am also Vedyam. Vedyam means I am the one who has to be known by all the jivas, ultimately should know me. Vedaischa Sarvaihi Ahameva Vedyaha. In all the Vedas, the main theme is Ishvara alone. So we have to know. When we know, we will come to know that the self, what I consider as I, is actually Ishvara alone. It doesn't have a form, it doesn't have a shape. See, when you talk about, somebody asks you, who are you? You give your name, you give your gender, you give your relationship, you give the place, address, so many things one can talk about oneself. But all that we talk about ourselves is about our body and about our mind, intellect. But even deeper than that is my existence. If I just look deep, I will find that I don't have any gender, no name, no nothing. That pure sense of I, which one experiences in deep sleep, doesn't have any gender, doesn't have any form, doesn't have any age. See, all of us are ageless. We don't have any age. Body might have age, but we don't have age. Body keeps on growing old and finally it is dropped, but the self is ageless. So there is no gender, there is no color, there is no boundary of any kind. That is the real myself, and that is not different from Ishvara. See, like our body, physically also, if we analyze, it is made up of various types of elements, chemicals. But if you analyze and draw the percentage of every element, you will find the same type of elements are there in the entire universe also. Same elements are there in the distant star, in the distant some galaxy. Same type of elements must be there, are there. Similarly, if we analyze ourselves and deeply go within, we'll find that what I call I is Ishvara alone. But at present we don't know. So I have to know Ishvara. So with the help of my mind, with the help of my intellect, with the help of the path shown in the scriptures, I have to know Ishvara. Know means realize. Know means not just theoretically, but actually. It is possible and one can know. So it's called avagati. Avagati paryantam jnanam. Knowledge till one gains that avagati means direct experience. So Vedyam, Bhagavan says, I am the Vedyam. Means the purpose of all the Vedas is to know God, is to realize God. It's not for any other purpose. Even the karma, upasana, jnanam slowly takes us toward this realization only. So Bhagavan says, I am Vedyam. In order to know Bhagavan, there should be, we have to have some praman. So that praman is the Vedas. Through our senses, we can know about the world. Through direct perception, through inference, through comparison, we can know about this world. Various praman, pratyaksha, anuman, upaman, arthapatti. We can know about this world. But about myself, about Ishvara, I cannot know by using this praman, because they don't reach there. See, when a person is sleeping, or even if a person is dreaming, suppose you want to see that person's dream, you can't. no, no, I will use some microscope to see what that fellow is dreaming. You can't. That's also my experience. I might dream, but nobody can see my dream. Unless I tell you, you will not know. No, no, I will use some special instrument and all sorts of brain scanning and all. Brain scanning and all, it will not help. Even CAT scanning will not help. One fellow brought his dog to the doctor. He says, I don't know what happened to the dog, please check it. Doctor checked. Then he got his cat, and the cat smelled the dog. And the doctor said, we have done all the check and also CAT scanning. But nothing can be done now. So with all our scanning and all, we will not be able to see other person's mind, other person's thoughts. And this Atma is even deeper than our thoughts. Deep sleep. We are alone with ourself. No mind, no thoughts, no indriyas can go there. So the only way we know about it is through the scriptures, through our Upanishad, through the Vedas, through Bhagavad Gita, through Puranas, through Itihas, Mahabharata, Ramayana. We can understand what that self is. So Bhagavan says that scripture, who has written it, who has given it, that also is given to us by Ishvara only. There is no human author of the scriptures. Scriptures means the Vedas, the Upanishads, the Gita. Gita, Bhagavan avatar he took and he presented that Gita, but for the Upanishads and Vedas, there are no human author. It comes through a medium of human being, it can come. But the author is not a human being. Because it cannot, what the subject cannot be grasped by human intellect. So therefore Bhagavan says, I myself am Rigved, Samaved, Yajurved. It's the Vedas are also manifestation of Ishvara only. Just like the sun and the moon and the stars and all the galaxies are manifestation of Ishvara, these Vedas are also manifestation of Ishvara. So Rig Ved, Sama Ved, Yajur Ved. See, many times people try to analyze all this using their historical or scientific knowledge and all, and come up with some dates. Oh, they say that Vedic Kala, and Rig Veda was first, and then other Vedas came and all. But we don't accept all this. We say Vedas are Anadi, Ananta, and Apaurusheya. They are not created or authored by. They can disappear for some time. In Kali Yuga and all, they may disappear. And again they appear. They appear through some person. So there are some great Rishi Munis who were born, and through them again the Vedic literature will again manifest. But they themselves are not the authors of these Vedas. So Bhagavan, they are Bhagavad Swarup only. Therefore he says, I am Rig Ved, Sam Ved, Yajur Ved. And what is the essence of all these Vedas? There are thousands of mantras are there in the Vedas, and all of them can be put into one sound, and that is Om. Bhagavan says, I am Pavitra, Pavitram Omkarah. I am the most Pavitra Omkar also. Even if you cannot chant all the Vedic literature, just when we chant Om, we are chanting all the essence of all the mantras. Pranava Sarva Vedeshu, in the 10th chapter, Bhagavan will tell, I am the Pranava in all the Vedas. So through this Pranava is Bhagavan's name. Pranava is support to know Bhagavan. Pranava means Om. Pranava is support to do upasana on Bhagavan. Pranava indicates Just that name indicates the various aspects of Bhagwan. He is Vaishvanara Roop, he is Hiranyagarbha, Ishvara, Brahma, Jagrat, Swapna, Sushupti, Turiya. All these are indicated by that sound Om. So it's the most holiest of all sound. See, the first word which we can, first sound which we can utter is A. If we just open our mouth and let the air come out with the sound, A. Even khana jyada hone ke baad bhi aisa hi sound aata hai kuch. A. And when you ask someone and that fellow doesn't know, tab bhi ye sound aata hai. A. So, A is the most basic sound. Even that itself, we teach children A and all in English also, but A, A is the sound. A itself then modifies to become A, 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 E, E, U, U, A, I, O, O, Am, A. So, all these various vowels are there. And when these vowels are connected to the consonants, then different, again different types of sounds, ka, kha, ga, 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 cha, cha, ja, ja, ya. So all these sounds are there. So among all the sound, basic sound which is pervading all sound is A. A itself becomes all other sound. Then in between sound is U. A, U, A, A, E, E, U. So A and U, according to Sanskrit rule, becomes O, O. So O is another sound. And then the last sound which we can utter is Ma. Om. So when we close our lips, then the last sound is Ma. So A, it's all our sound begins with A, in between U, and the last is Ma. So Om represents all sounds, means all letters, all words, means all names. See, this entire world which is made up of different forms, all these forms they have names, and all these names are different expression of Om only. So the world is Om, and world is Ishvara, so Ishvara is also Om, Hiranyagarbha is Om, Vaishvanara is Om, all beings are Om, all objects are Om. So by just meditating on this Om and understanding the deep significance of Om, we can realize ourselves as that Omkar Roop Bhagwan. See, even nowadays, in science also, they keep on doing a lot of research. One of the research which they are doing is to find out the sound when the creation began so many billions of years ago, according to science, their investigation. Still it is being done. So they say that long time ago, there was this, the entire universe was like a singularity, and there was a big bang and it started expanding. So within seconds actually the universe expanded into the very large form, within seconds. And during that period, all these finer particles, maybe helium, hydrogen and all were there. There was no light, total darkness and only this. So during that time, there was some sound in the universe. So they tried to, using all the radio telescope or whatever instrument, they have tried to figure out that sound. And according to some research and all, that sound is something like Om only. The sound is something like Om. The background music is like something like Om. Om. something like that. The sound. See, every object, it has got its own sound. It has got its own typical sound. Every object, even parts of object, even our body, if you hit your hand at different places, including your stomach, you will get different type of sound. Sar pe bhi khali hai, bara hua hai. Uske anusar sound, different sound comes. So every object has got its own sound. So the form is there and its own sound is there, which is also together with that object. So similarly, this whole universe, when it was totally, when in the initial stages of creation, the sound which was there was Om. And that same sound is present. Then it kept on becoming more and more complex. More and more complex objects and all started appearing. So that Om itself modified into various different types of sound. So even from the standpoint of the sound and the vibrations, etc., this Om has got a powerful, deep meaning and significance. So Bhagavan says this, I am of the nature of, I am Om, I am that Pavitram Omkar. So even if we chant Om, keeping in mind that this is Bhagavan's name, it is a great sadhana. It's very pure sound. Therefore, before we start any class or any of our puja, etc., we begin with that Om, Omkar. So, Vedyam Pavitram Omkaraha Rig Sama Yajurevacha. Bhagavan says, I am the Rig Ved, Yajur Ved, Sama Ved also. Then further beautiful words in which again through various these words, the nature of Ishvara is indicated. Who is Ishvara? See this verse, very beautiful. It will be nice if you can even by heart it. It indicates who Ishvara is. Because many times people also when they ask, Are kon, Bhagavan kon hai, we give our own story. We should never give our story. We should tell what the scriptures says, not what you think it is. And not from just like from some articles here or there. People keep on writing. But find out what the scriptures say. So what does the scriptures say about Ishvara? It says, Gatir Bharta Prabhu Sakshi Nivasa Sharanam Surta Prabhava Pralayasthanam Nidhanam Bijam Avvayam Gatir Bharta Prabhu Sakshi. Gati hi. Bhagavan is Gati. Gati means the goal or the result. Karma phalam. When we perform karma, we get the result. That result is also Bhagavan only. Bhagavan is of the nature of the result which we get. See, when we perform karma, according to our karma, we get the result. If papa karma is there, then dukkha, punya karma is there, we get sukha. And based on the karma, we get the different bodies, human body, animal, bird, plant. Based on the karma, we go to different lokas. Based on our karma, we get a particular type of family in this world. We get a particular place where we are born, particular time at which we are born. Everything depends on the karma. And Bhagavan himself is that karma phala. He is the gati. also he is the ultimate gati. See, we get little karma phala, little joy, but what is the ultimate, infinite joy and infinite karma phala, or the ultimate phala, is Bhagwan himself. So he is the gati, he is the goal, gati hi. He is bharta. Bharta means poshta, means one who nourishes. Ishvara alone nourishes us through this karma phalas, by giving us the proper anna at different stages in our life, giving us the right type of experiences in different stages of our life. See, for example, our dream. What type of dream you will dream on a particular day, particular night, we don't know. We have so much of samskar that we can have different types of dream. But it is Ishvara alone who then selects what type of dream you should have today. So he gives that. According to our karma, he gives a phala of a particular dream also. Some people keep getting bad dreams because of their karma. Some keep getting good dreams because of karma. In our dream also, we come to know what are our weaknesses and what are our positive things. Bhagwan comes and tells us, ki, these are your weaknesses. You better take care of them. Privately, he tells. Nobody knows. We only know what we dreamt. So privately, he tells, Baba, ye aapka weakness hai, jara dekh lo. Also, when we do our sadhana, when it goes really deep, it expresses in our dreams also. Therefore, Tulsidas ji in Ramayana, he tells that when you love Bhagwan, your love should get expressed even in your dream. If in your dream you don't love, that means you have not gone really deep. Nahi, jagrat mein to hamare haath mein, jagrat mein you do your sadhana, but when you come, when you get a dream that you are doing your sadhana even in your dream, then it's very good. Then it has gone deep. Even in your dream, if you are good. See, nobody gives punishment if I am bad in my dream. But I myself can judge. Kahi log jagrat mein bade achhe hote hai, dream mein bade shaitan hote hai. Gadbad kaam karte hai. So even in our dream, we should be good. Then it's good. So Ishvara gives us all this phala and nourishes us at all time. So he is the bharta. He says that, our whole life is, and all that happens, is not fully under our control. It is Ishvara who takes care of us. So he is the bharta. He is Prabhu, he is the Swami, he is the master of this entire universe. See, if I look at my life, I feel I am the master. Then I little analyze it closely, then I come to know there are other masters around us. One person came to someone's house and he says, I want to speak to the master of the house. So andar wo jhagad rahe the. Unhone kaha, you please wait, we are deciding that only. The same issue is being discussed now. So we think we are master, but come to know that somebody else is the master. Then that fellow also thinks he is the master, then comes to know that aur koi sab cheez control kar raha hai. Once a person was taking his that cow, he had tied with a rope and was taking the cow, hitting the cow also. So one master with his disciple, he saw that and he asked his disciple, who is the master here? So everyone said that person is a master. So the teacher said that if the cow is released from that bondage, who will go after whom? He says, cow will go independently, that fellow will follow. Sometimes you find people take their dogs for a walk and all. the person might feel he is the master, but if you really ask and know dog language, the dog might say they have some different view. So if the dog, you hear the dog talking to other dog, good, we don't know the language. The dog might be saying ki after kitne din ke baad unko zara samjhaya kaise chalna chahiye. Anyway, so we feel we are the master. Then we come to know, no, we are not the master. Somebody else is controlling my life. The society is controlling, the government is controlling this world. Some leader is controlling, national, international politics is controlling. But if you go on looking, then we come to know the devatas are controlling our life. See, in Ramayana we find Ramchandraji, his abhishek was about to happen, and the devatas had an emergency meeting. They said, ye toh gadbad baat hai. If Ramchandra ji remains in Ayodhya, wo Ravan ko kaun marega? Aur dusre sab rakshas ko kaun marega? This is not good. This is not done. So they had an emergency meeting, and then they decided ki kuch toh karna chahiye. We have to change the mati. We can't change Ramchandra ji's mati. We can't change the mati of all the Ayodhya vasis also, because they are so devoted to Bhagwan that you can't change their thought, their thinking. But then they came to know that there was one foreigner there, Manthara. So they changed the mati of Manthara, the devatas. So through her, Kaikeyi's mati got changed. Through that, everything got disturbed and Bhagwan had to go to the forest. So one may feel that, oh, I am taking my decision, I am going here, it is my life, I am controlling it. But you don't know, the devatas are controlling. Indra, Varun, Kuber, all these devatas, Kamadev, it is that, all these devatas, they control our life. If the devatas themselves feel that we are controlling, they don't know. Their higher lokapalas are there who control their life. Their higher world, Prajapati is there who controls his life. Then Hiranyagarbha is there. And finally, Ishvara is there who controls everyone's life. Ishvara is the master of this entire creation. Without even moving, just by his very presence, he is controlling the entire show. He is also called Antaryami, remaining inside and being all, he controls all. So he is the master, Prabhu. Therefore we should go to the direct Prabhu, the direct boss. In between ke paas jaake koi fayda nahi hai. Direct Bhagwan ke saath, one has to develop their rapport. Then there is no problem. Beech ke chatarpatar logo ke saath kuch karne ki zarurat nahi. So he says, I am Prabhu. Okay, you might be Prabhu, but kahan kya ho raha hai, aapko kya pata? Sab jage CCTV to nahi laga sakte hai. Bhagwan says, no, I am the Sakshi. I am the witness of everything which happens in this world. Nothing is missed by me. It's the Sakshi. Sakshi means what? Praninam krita akritasya. Whatever the prani is, the beings, not only human beings. Many times we feel Bhagwan is meant only for human beings. No, he is the Ishvara of all beings. So every prani, whatever they do, and they don't do, or do good or bad, Bhagwan is the witness, he is the Sakshi of everything. Remaining in the heart of everyone as the Atma, Bhagwan witnesses everything. Witness means he knows, but he doesn't get involved. Sakshi hai. Beech mein interfere nahi karte hai. But he sees everything. Just like the light. That light is as though Sakshi of all that is happening here. People come, people go, whatever they do. Like this example is given of the light in a drama. So before the drama begins, the light is there. The drama is going on, light is there, illuminating everything. Drama is over, all of them go away. The light illumines the empty stage without interfering. If there is someone says some wrong dialogue, the light will not interfere. Someone says right dialogue, the light will not say anything. It illumines everything. So similarly, Bhagavan is the Sakshi, the witness. He is the witness of everything which happens. He is Nivasaha. He is the home of all beings. Everyone resides in Ishvara. Hum sab unhi ki god mein hai. Every being is residing where? In Ishvara only. Because whole world is his prakriti. Every being is residing. So Nivasaha yasmin praninaha nivasanti. All the pranis, they reside. Nivasaha sharanam. He is the sharanam. He is the refuge. He is the one to whom we can go if we are in trouble also. Not that we should wait for trouble to come, but he is the refuge for those who are in trouble. Artanam prapannanam artiharaha. He is the one who dispels all the trouble of those who are in trouble when they surrender to him. In the 18th chapter also, Bhagavan tells Arjuna that you surrender to me, I will release you of all your sins. Sarva dharman parityajya mam ekam sharanam vraja aham tva sarva papebhya mokshayishyami ma shuchah. So he is the sharanam, ultimate refuge. See, Bhagavat may be, there is a story. Whose story is there? Jinhone wo vrat rakha tha. Durvasa Rishi also came then. Ambarish. Ambarish was a great bhakta of Bhagavan. And he had taken some vrata. But then this Durvasa Rishi came. And Durvasa Rishi wanted to eat before the vrata was over. Something like that story, I don't recollect the whole thing. But then Bhagavan's Sudarshan Chakra, it followed him everywhere. And finally he had to surrender to Bhagavan only. So he is the ultimate refuge. In Ramayana also there is a story of Jayanta. He also tried to test Ramchandra ji. As a crow, he took the form of a crow. Then Bhagavan sent a blade of grass after him. Making that blade of grass as Brahmastra, he sent it behind that crow. So that crow just flew. He went to his father. He said, father said, I can't protect you. He went to all the devatas. They said, we can't protect you. Then he surrendered to Bhagavan himself and he protected, he blessed him. So he is the ultimate sharanam, ultimate refuge for everyone. Bhagavan is also very beautiful. He is Suhrut. Suhrut means our friend. Well-wisher. Rut means heart. One who has good heart. Means well-wisher, our well-wisher. Bhagavan is our well-wisher. See, this is very important actually. Because we get influenced by different types of cultures and different types of philosophies and different views and all. And we have lost touch with our own scriptures. Bhagavan is our friend. We should not be afraid of Bhagavan. We should have love for him. That God-fearing, we should not be God-fearing. That fear is not what the scriptures talk about. Our scriptures. We should have love. Because he is our friend. Sakha. Bhagavan is our Sakha. Sakha Panduranga. Sakha. Sakha is a friend. Friend is who, with whom we can share. With whom we confide. Who we feel we are close to that person. Is our friend. So Bhagavan is the closest. So he is Sakha, Surut. Then Prabhava Pralayam Sthanam Nidhanam Bijam Avyayam. Bhagavan is Prabhava. Prabhava means the very source from whom the entire creation has come. The entire creation has come from that Ishvara alone. See, just as when we are asleep, dreamless, kuch nahi hai. Na mai hu, na jagat hai, na man hai, na buddhi hai, na sharir hai. Kuch nahi hai. Then suddenly the dream comes. Then we come into the waking. From that, almost like nothing, means from that which we can't even describe, the entire world came. Similarly, from that Ishvara, whom we cannot describe, we cannot comprehend, from him, the entire creation has come. So he is the Prabhava of this whole world. And pralayam, pralayaha also, means the entire world again merges back into him. Therefore, we say he is the upadan karan. Everything comes from him and merges back into him. The world doesn't merge back into something else. It goes back into Ishvara. So he is pralayaha. And sthanam also, he is the one in whom the world exists. So the entire creation exists in Ishvara. He is also nidhanam. Nidhanam means what? That he is the one in whom all the karmas of all the beings also reside, which gives result in future. All of them reside in Ishvara. See, even when the entire pralaya happens, all the jivas, the entire creation merges into Ishvara. Ishvara alone exists that time. And from him again the entire creation comes back. So where did all of us reside? In him only. Where did all our karmas reside? In him. Sab kuch unhi mein rehta hai. He is the nidhanam, the very source in which, in whom all the karmas which we get the result in various times reside. He is also bijam, the very seed of everyone and everything. Bijam. And what type of bijam? Avyayam. See, generally bij get destroyed and the tree comes. But Bhagavan is not that destructible bija, is avyayam. Bija of this world, means this world constantly come into manifestation, remains and again merges back. Anadi, ananta, continues. There are infinite jivas and the world also keep on coming. So srishti, sthiti, laya, this chakra keep on happening. So it's avyaya bija of this world. So that is the nature. So gatir bharta prabhus sakshi nivasa sharanam sahrata prabhava pralaya sthanam nidhanam bijam avyayam. So all these indicators of Ishvara, this Ishvara we should love, we should dedicate our life. You can name him or you can worship him any form, as it was said, ekatvena, pratatvena, or bahuda vishvato mukham, in whatever way. One can worship that Ishvara. But he is the Ishvara. So further, Bhagavan says, tapamyahamaham varsham nigrandhamyusrujamicha amritam caiva mrityuscha sadasachaham arjuna tapamyahamaham varsham nigrandhamyusrujami cha. Bhagavan says tapami aham, it is I myself who heats up this entire world also. See, all our dharti, this entire earth, gets heated by what? By the light of that sun, by the heat of the sun. But that heat of the sun belongs to Ishvara alone. So through the sun, with the heat, Bhagavan says, I only heat up the entire world. See, because of the presence of sun, there is different seasons on earth. And the earth keeps on revolving, rotating, and different seasons keep on coming. So who creates all this? It's Ishvara alone. So tapami aham. And aham varsham, and it is I who gives rains to this world. At regular interval, regular seasons they come, and Bhagavan alone is the one who gives us appropriate rains also. So tapami aham. So it is Bhagavan is not only giving the karma phala for individuals like this, but even all that is happening in nature is also controlled and guided by that Ishvara alone. See, the scriptures don't talk about an inert world. When we talk about this world, that world is a living God only. There is no such thing called inert. There is no such thing called, insentient in that sense. The world which we see in front of us is Ishvara alone. The earth is alive, the moon, the sun is alive, the entire creation is alive. There is that life force which is controlling the entire. Just like our own body, if suppose you try to see a little portion of our body under the microscope and all, it is made up of material, it is made up of chemicals. All these are chemicals only. All that laddu, peda, jalebi, rice, parathe, what you eat, may go to make our body. But all these are nothing but material. Molecules, atoms. Finally, this whole body is made up of atoms. Billions and billions of atoms are there. If you keep on splitting, you will find that it's made up of atoms only. Those atoms are put together into particular form, it becomes molecules. All these molecules together, they form different types of structure, but ultimately they are just atoms. So if you just look at those atoms, you will not find any life there. It is just following the rules of physics, you will say. According to the rules of physics, the electron keep on moving. So where is life? Kaha hai? Dikhai nahi degi. So if under the microscope, the tiniest particle, if we try to see, you will think that it is just a material object. Similarly, this vast universe in which we are so tiny little, and when we look at a small little portion, we think it is inert, but life is there. That life is guiding and controlling everything in this world. Agni, Jala, Prithvi, everything is controlled by that Ishvara who alone is expressing as this vast universe. That Ishvara we call Vaishvanara, when he expresses as this vast universe. So Bhagavan alone is there who heats up this world, who gives rain at particular time. Then Nigrunnami, he withdraws that rain also and from this world. Nigrunnami ushrujami cha, and again pours out. So during the summers and all, Bhagavan keeps on soaking all the waters, and then during rainy season he pours it on, down again. So Nigrunnami ushrujami cha, all this Bhagavan alone does. Amrutam chamrityuscha, he alone is amrutam, a long, immortal means long life for this devatas is also Bhagavan only. Bhagavan alone is giving long life to devatas. See, there are these various devatas are there who live for a period of one manvantar. Agni Devata, Varuna Devata, Indra Devata, they also have their lifespan, a long one. because it is very long compared to human life, it is almost called Amrutam only, immortal. So that long life is given by Ishvara. And human being, they have a short span of life. We are born and we die. Compared to the devatas, our lifespan is so short. And the flow of this time also moves in a different way for us. For Brahmaji, the time moves in a different way. 1 second of Brahmaji might be so many years for a human being. So Brahmaji just takes a nap and wakes up, the entire generation is gone. Just imagine. Brahmaji is just say, chalo, let me relax for some time. Gone. Are you India independence ke abhi bahut saal beet gaye. Hundreds of years gone. So our life is so tiny, flimsy compared to the life scale of the devatas and also of Brahmaji. But all this is given by Ishvara alone. So he is the life. He is immortality as well as death. So Amrutam Chaiva Mrityushcha Sadasachaham Arjuna. Hey Arjuna, I am Sat as well as Asat. Here Sat means the cause, Karanam. And Asat is Karya. Means the Karan of this world is also Ishvara. And the world, the Karya is also Ishvara. Sat means that which is changeless reality is called Sat. Asat is changing reality. Just like clay and pot. So pot is a changing reality. And clay is a changeless reality. So the changeless reality here is called Sat. Changing is called Asat. So Bhagavan says, I myself am Sat as well as Asat. Sada Sat cha aham Arjuna. Hey Arjuna. So this is the Ishvara whom we should worship. Through our prayer, we should pray to him. Puja we should do of this Ishvara. Japa we should do of Ishvara's name. Meditation we should do on Ishvara, his form, either universal form or his form as one avatar, as Ram or Krishna, or the form described in our scriptures like Vishnu or Shiva, or so many various ways description is given. One should meditate and worship this Ishvara. But there are people who might not understand this, ignorant about the presence and the nature of Ishvara, and they want little joys and little results of karma only. So there are people who are so-called, they perform various types of rituals, they follow the ritual given in the Vedas, etc. But they desire not Ishvara, but their desire is to go to Swarga, etc. So here in the following words, Bhagavan says that even the Swarga Prapti is a limited result only. He says, even if you go to Swarga, there is no permanent residence there. So he says in the following verses, Traividya mam somapa puta papaha. Yadnye rishtva swargatim prarthayante. Te punyama sadhya surendra lokam. Ashtnanti divyan divideva bhogan. Te tam bhuktva swargalokam vishalam. Kshine punye martyalokam vishante. Evam traya dharmya manuprapannaha. Gatagatam kama kama labhante. Together. Trayvidya mam soma paputa papaha yajne rishtva svargatim pratayante te punyamasadya surendra lokam ashnanti divyan divideva bhogan te tam bhuktva svargalokam vishalam kshine punye martyalokam vishanti evam traidharmya manuprapannaha gatagatam kama kama labhante. Bhagavan says, Trayvidya mam soma paputa papaha. See, in our Vedas, there is two important bhag portion is there. The first or the initial portion of the Vedas talk about different types of karma, the karma kanda portion. And the later half or later portion of Vedas talk about jnana. So in the Upanishad are given the jnana, and in the initial portion there is karma, and different types of upasanas are also mentioned. See, karma is meant for fulfilling our desires, but if the karmas are done properly, it works, it is meant to purify our mind. Through karma we purify our mind, through upasana we can bring about ekagrata in our mind. So chitta shuddhi and chitta ekagrata we can attain through karma and upasana, which is given in the initial portion of the Vedas. But there are, this also is used to fulfill our desires. Because people in the beginning, they are attracted towards karma only to fulfill their desires. So the scriptures guide them. You do this karma, you will get this result. You do this karma, you will get this result. You do this upasana, you will get this. So they get attracted towards following the rituals and all. Then slowly the Vedas tell them that if you do it with nishkam bhavana, it will purify your mind. It will make your antakarana shuddha. You don't have to go to swargalok or some other loka to gain happiness. You can gain it here and now. You can become more peaceful and happy. So slowly the Vedas guide people on the path of karma yoga, nishkam karma. And then slowly, when one gains vairagya, one can follow the path of jnanam and gain the final state of enlightenment. So Vedic, path is there, or the purpose is there to take all beings ultimately to the goal of moksha. So different beings are there. Everyone is guided towards the path of moksha. But there are some people who get stuck on the earlier path. Some people get stuck on doing all rituals only to get limited results in this world or in other worlds. So Bhagavan is, those who are in the borderline, means they are almost there, Bhagavan is telling us the limitation of this so that they can rise above and gain vairagya. So here, through this, Bhagavan is cultivating vairagya in those who are doing rituals for the sake of fulfilling their limited desires. He said, these people, Trayvidya, they might be knowing the Vedas, all the Vedas, Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sama Veda, all the three Vedas. Three includes the fourth one also, the Atharva Veda. Trayvidya mam soma pa, those who drink the soma. Soma is type of rasa from some plant, which is also part of the ritual that they takes this some soma. Soma is not some drink and all, alcohol or something. It is a some type of plant which is part of the ritual. Ritual may be kuch khana padta hai, pina padta hai. Even there are some rituals where we take go maya also. Go mutra and all. So part of the ritual. So through the soma pa and by understanding the Vedas, when they do these rituals, puta papa ha, they become purified of all their papa. Papa is that which gives us sorrow. Papa, actually we have lived in this world from beginningless time. So from beginningless time, performing karmas, God knows how many times we have done all sorts of wrong karmas. Because till we come in contact with some good person or till we come in contact with the right type of scriptures and all, our life is guided by our desires only. Animal, birds, plant, that life is guided by desires. Human beings also, those who don't have any other thing, their life is guided by desires. Then government and all have to create laws to control their desires, so that fellow lives and allows others to live also. Like our traffic rules and all. If there is no traffic rules, everyone, for few minutes the signal is not working, a big chaos and all. Everyone wants to cross. Everyone is right in the middle of the road. Vaise bhi middle of the road only. Still the time is there, but this fellow is already half on the road. So that he blocks the ongoing traffic also, and he waits for his turn to come. Then he's on the way, like, just when the signal changes, he rushes. So everyone tries to fulfill their desire, to control this mass of people. There are laws in the world. Similarly, there are laws in the scriptures. That aisa karo, aisa mat karo, this is vidhi, this is nished. So when one does what is nished, then we incur sin. When we do what is vidhi, we get punya. So when we perform these rituals properly, all our papa gets washed away. So puta papaha, those who have cleaned their system of lot of their papa, yajne rishtva swargatim prarthayante, they perform various types of yajna, which are given in the scriptures. But what is their purpose? Swargatim prarthayante. They do prarthana that after this death, I will get lot of punya and I should go to swarga. So there are people who believe in the Vedas. Therefore they believe in the life after death. Therefore they believe in all the lokas also. And following the rituals, they want to go to swarga. Ki yahan bahut ho gaya. करोल बाग में रह रहे का परेशानी हो गई है, पानी नहीं आता है, लाइट बिजली चली जाती है, गवर्नमेंट ठीक काम नहीं करता है, रिक्शा वाले एक्स्ट्रा पैसा लेते हैं, सो लेट मी गो टू स्वर्ग. देन दे परफॉर्म देयर रिचुअल, बिकॉज स्वर्ग मीन्स नॉट दैट वी गिव बेनिफिट ऑफ डाउट टू एवरीवन. वो कहाँ गए आपके दादाजी, वो स्वर्गवासी हो गए. वी गिव बट वी नेवर नो. That fellow may be roaming around some other place. ये कौन है आपके दादाजी, अच्छा ये यहाँ क्यों आ गए. So we never know. But if we perform the rituals properly, we can go to swarga. So swargatim prarthayante, they desiring swarga, they perform various types of ritual, agnishtoma and all different types of yajnas are there. And when we perform these rituals, papa is also negated, and what happens? Punyam asadhya. We accumulate lot of punya. So te punyam asadhya. And when a person dies, this jiva goes to swarga. And what is this swarga? Surendra lokam. It is the loka where Indra Bhagavan stays. Is the world where Indra, who is the lord of all the devatas, he stays there. So we go to that loka, those people who do this, they go to that loka, Surendra lokam. And there, in that, we get special type of body there, which is called bhoga sharir. In Narak, if one goes, it's called yatna sharir. That yatna, the much more than what we experience here in this world. See this, in this world, the limit of sukha and dukkha is there. After we cross a particular limit of pain, we become unconscious. Because that is how Bhagavan has made the arrangement here. कि इसको ज़्यादा सहन नहीं हो सकता है, इसको जरा अनकॉन्शियस कर दो. But in Narak and all, we get special body. That one gets so much of pain, but nothing, one remains conscious only. And one doesn't die there, because मर के ही वहाँ गए हैं, वहाँ पर और क्या मरेंगे. ऐसा नहीं कि बहुत एकदम ज़्यादा उसको उबालना नहीं तेल में, मर जाएगा. मरा क्या, मरा हुआ ही यहाँ पर आ गया है. So there is no fear of death in Narak, and there is no fear of death in Swarga also. But there is a time limit. See, everyone has gone there and come, so we might not remember. We don't remember, but since we are here for from beginningless time, we must have gone many times. Garam garam tel mein. So, next time when you do pakode and all, you can keep this in mind. So, te punya mahasadya surendra lokam ashnanti. Now we are talking about swarga. Huh? So, surendra lokam ashnanti, they enjoy. What do they enjoy there? Divyan divideva bhogan. There one enjoys divya bhog, which are enjoyed by the devatas. Special bhoga, extreme this pleasure. Swarga, pleasure only, but extreme pleasure. And in Narak, extreme pain. So one experiences extreme pleasure in Swarga, that is Divyan Divideva Bhogan. But the period, it is like our punya gets exhausted there, because it is punya phala. So as we experience that bhoga, our punya keeps on reducing. There a person doesn't grow old, and also he doesn't know that he will exit from this swarga. Here at least we can roughly tell. But there, everyone remains young, I think so. We have to read in the scriptures exactly. But there is no that old age, disease, death and all like that type. So, the punya is exhausted. So, te tam bhuktva swargalokam vishalam. They are enjoying the swarga vishal, swargalok for a long time. Kshine punne, slowly when the punya become kshina, is exhausted. What happened? Marte lokam vishanti. That person comes back into Pat Pat Ganj. Or Chandni Chowk, depends on the karma phala. Or any other place. Huh? These are just examples. Because some people might want to be born somewhere else. So, again, we are born in this Marte. This is called, Earth is called Marte Lok. In this vast cosmos, this is the place where we are there, born in this earth. See, till now, scientists are looking for life elsewhere. They have not found. We are the only one. It's like a vast cosmos is there, and we are like alone in this vast cosmos, on this earth. Alone, roaming around in this vast space. So, Kshine punye martyalokam vishanti evam traidharmyam anuprapannaha. In this way, these people who perform these rituals which are mentioned in the three Vedas, and who are these people? Kama kamaha, those who desire, those who have desire for desires. See, there are seekers who desire that my desire should go away. See, there are, when desire comes, the spiritual seeker wants the desire to get eliminated. Through proper thinking, proper contemplation, that person wants the desire to just go away. But other people want the desire to be fulfilled. And when one desire fulfilled, they feel happy. So they want more and more desires. Therefore, chutti ke dinon mein and all, they say, "Are, kya karenge? Kuch bolo na, kuch batao. Give me desire. So, kama kamaha they are called. They are desirers of desire. So these desirers of desire, kama kamaha gata gatam labante, they gain this result of what? Of going and coming. They go to swarga, come back. They go to swarga, come back. If their papa is there, they go to narak, come back. So gata gatam. If we keep on going and coming, we might get a pass also. Seasons pass. Gata gatam. Achha, aa gaya tu wapas, haan, theek. नहीं इस बार थोड़ा नरक का भी वास मुझे मिला है आई विल गो देयर एंड कम बैक और गुरुदेव इज टू टेल फनी थिंग्स अबाउट दिस स्वर्ग एंड नरक ऑल्सो दैट वन फेलो वॉज गोइंग टू स्वर्ग एंड ही सॉ ऑन द वे नरक वॉज देयर एंड देयर वॉज ऑल मक एंड डर्ट वॉज देयर गंदगी थी एंड पीपल वॉज स्टैंडिंग इन दैट टोटली नेक डीप in that muck. But they had, he used to say, they had in their hand hot South Indian coffee. And music was playing in the music system. So this fellow was going to Swarga and he looked from the window there. He said, very good. I never knew Narak is such advanced, only neck deep in dirt, but they are getting nice music and coffee also is there. After some time, suddenly the music stopped and there was announcement, okay, coffee time over, now back on your heads. So, Swarga and Narak is quite in funny places, but they are there. So, gata gatam kama kama labhante. So, if we do rituals, we get this temporary result, we come back. Therefore, Bhagavan says, if you want eternal happiness and peace, worship me and attain me. So that he will say in the next verse, we will see it tomorrow.
पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः हरिः ॐ श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ